Okay, good evening everyone and thank you for coming. My name is Diego Lagum. I'm a developer. I have been a developer for more than 20 years. My first important job was in C language, and by then I was working in a myriad of languages ranging from COBOL to C Sharp, Java, etc. But the language of choice for me is C++, so I'm really pretty happy of being here tonight. So you can consider me today a guy who is focused on both enterprise development, and I'm not using C++ for that, and also getting some focus on what it's called today the post-PC industry. So you can consider I am a post-PC C++ activist because I'm really trying to push and promote C++ in this new world. I want to learn a little bit about you. How many of you guys are these days focused on, let's say, tablet and smartphone applications? We got like a couple. And are you guys using C++ for these kind of apps? No? Okay. So kind of 50-50. That's great. This is what we are going to talk tonight. First of all, I want to make clear, when we talk about post-PC, there are certain debates. Some people say, no, I don't believe that that is going to happen, etc. What I will show first is that this is already happening. So we are not discussing whether it's going to happen or not, or when it's going to happen. It's already happening. I'm showing statistics, showing that this is already happening, which is a crisis in some way, because maybe what we are doing won't be necessary in maybe, you know, in the next few years. Is also an opportunity. And you know, as C++ developers, what can we do, you know, in this new scenario? I will later talk about C++ in the leading post-PC platforms. By leading post-PC platforms, I want to be explicit. I will show you through demos C++ in Android and in iOS. Both together comprise the 90% of the post-PC landscape. I will focus next on the notion that post-PC applications are not exactly like, okay, these are like PC applications but in a small screen. There are a lot of considerations to take when you think about tablet and smartphone applications. I will focus a little bit about that and want to make some emphasis on that because there are some inherent complexities in these new kind of applications that make me realize C++ in any case should actually help us and not be yet another obstacle, you know? I will elaborate a little bit more about that in a few minutes. So I will later talk what I see wrong about C++ these days. And this could be maybe a thought-provoking discussion, or you can just believe that I'm too much opinionated. It's maybe a space for us to debate a little bit, to compare the evolution of C++ contrasting with other languages. And I will tell you what I see wrong there and why I consider that C++ could miss the opportunity in the post-PC era. But in order to provide a happy ending in this talk, I will tell you what the community is doing about C++ for post-PC development and maybe the chance that could be beyond the platforms that are available, you know, from Microsoft, from Google, or from Apple. So I said I was to talk, first of all, about certain stats that are showing that the post-PC era has already come. So this is comparing the last quarter with the same quarter a year ago. And we can see here that the PC segment, the one that is in the bottom of these stacks, is the one that is constantly decreasing and has been decreasing in the last few years. This is measuring millions of units of shipments. And when we say PCs, we are not just talking about desktop computers. This also comprises notebooks, etc. In comparison, smartphones have been growing, but what it should call the attention is that tablets, in particular, are growing very fast. You know, they are coming from behind because tablets are like the latest form factor that has been incorporated. That is actually arguable, you know? I mean, tablets were invented maybe 10 years ago, in 2002, by Microsoft. It's just that the era of commoditization happened in 2010 when Apple releases the iPad, you know, or if you like, maybe when Kindle started the, releasing the ebook readers, etc. So this is the same view, but now instead of talking about absolute millions of units shipped, this is the percentual participation. So again, you can see that tablets have been doubling their participation, you know, in the last year. And you can also have a dimension of how PCs are decreasing. So as I was saying before, together, iOS and Android at this time are grabbing 90% of this new scenario. The next stat and the last stat I was going to show, and I will later focus on C++ topics, is maybe the one that shocks me more. We can consider that Android is actually a flavor based on Linux, right? And what we can see here in this chart is now together PCs, smartphones, and tablets and their participation these days. I mean, the install base of these three form factors all together. So in this 3% arranged as others, we can consider this is like the Linux flavors that are powering PCs these days. So if we consider that we have Linux there and Android is a flavor of Linux, Linux, which is the operating system that has the lowest participation in the PC industry, is the one that in the compounded world has the larger share, right? Then it comes Apple with iOS and Mac together, 19%, and back to back is Microsoft, which still enjoys 90% of the PC market. But this is a market that is shrinking, you know, so we may expect, if the trend doesn't change, we may expect that in the times to come, actually, Microsoft participation is going to be lower. So I will later provide with the sources of all this information. This is nothing that I'm here, just supposing this is something that certain analysts and market watchers have been collecting and showing. So now is the main question. We know that iOS and Android own the 90% or command the 90% of this new scenario. What is C++ in those scenarios? I will focus on these two platforms tonight, and I will show you through demos how this works. So let's start with iOS first. So, are you familiar with Objective-C as a language? I mean, experience. Are you familiar with Objective-C++? Barely. Okay. So, Objective-C++ is this Janus god that appears in the middle of this figure. So we have an Objective-C component that at some point needs to call, you know, the native platform or talk, you know, about a C++ component or C component directly running on the metal. So what this, this Objective-C component does is talks directly with this man in the middle with two faces, this Objective-C++ component. It looks like Objective-C code, but at the same time, because Objective-C is an extension of C language, it contains certain lines of C that at the same time can trigger or request certain methods to be executed or functions to be executed to C++ instances. So let's see it in a demo, and maybe we will understand better what I'm talking about. Let's see. I guess that for this, it would be better that I maximize my screen. I know that the characters are too small. I will do something about it. So, sorry. This is the Android example. Just a minute. There we go. Working with two screens too wide sometimes becomes problematic. Okay. So, there we go. What I have here is a very simple program. It's an Objective-C application. I don't expect you to read what I have there, then I will maximize the code. Let's just run this application right away. I will show you first what the application does, then we will dissect the application structure and we will better understand how this works. So what I have here is the post-PC version of Hello World. So I will put here Northwest C++ user group and will later press this button. So let's just not focus for this time in the breakpoints I have. Let's see the application again. Oops. Okay, there we go. So I will show you later in better detail what the application is doing, but basically was triggering certain actions in C++ components. We will see how that happens, and was making, you know, like certain computation, etc., and working with strings in the C++ world. So let's focus on the source code in a better, bigger detail. In general, iPhone applications start with a main class that is an Objective-C one. Can you see this better? It's readable. What about the end of? Cool. Okay, so what we can see here, you know, this is not rocket science. This comes from the old C language. But what we have here in this class is we are triggering this Cocoa component. Cocoa is the framework that fuels, you know, Apple applications in general, both in Mac and iOS. So it's actually bootstrapping this element, and it's sending us an argument. This class, you know, it's called, in this case, Hello World App Delegate. It's a class that I have generated. This class has the basic method that a window or application should have to deal with application events, like the application is losing focus, etc. You don't need, as developers in Xcode, you don't need to really build this application. You can eventually fork the logic of this application, but this class comes with certain logic by default. So what is this related with our class? What we have here is this other component. You know, it's something that Mac emphasizes, is the Model View Controller programming model. Can you still read these characters here? I don't believe that. I can move the screen. Okay, there we go. So what I have in this controller are certain methods, like, for instance, grid user here. This is still an Objective C++ method, but this method will invoke a class that is in the Objective C++ world. So this class will receive the message and will be a broker with the C++ component. Let's go there and see it in further detail. So let's see. This is the method that I was talking about. This is still an Objective C++ component, but this Objective C++ component has a field that is straight, you know, a pointer to a C++ class. I will run the demo again. I will put some breakpoints this time, and you will see how the chain of delegation works in this case. Let me just make my screen smaller. I cannot work with two screens, you know. So I will try to cheat us again. When I do it, you might see here there is a stack. I don't know if I can maximize this portion of the screen. Yes, I think I can. Yes, I could, at least. Let me try to, I'm trying to push the boundary, you know, this side. Okay, maybe too much. There we go. Okay, so This is the method I was talking before, you know, greet user. This is an Objective-C++ component. And this component is asking this other component, person, which is an Objective-C++ component, okay, I want you to get initiated, and the name that is sending in the string is directly coming from the field in the screen, from the, you know, the UI. When this guy is instantiating, this is the Objective-C++ component, this guy is directly instantiating a C++ object and is sending that argument, you know, as initial value. Now we are in the C++ camp. We are creating our own instance. Is it clear enough? This example? Is it understandable? So here is jumping in the stack. This is the moment we are constructing our instance. I will now keep running. I think that I need to press again. Sorry. Maybe making this a little bit smaller, so. Okay. So we are still in this method, greet user. Now we are like an instruction after the instruction that instantiated our class. And we are asking our proxy, this person, we are trying to format the greeting message. And in order to do that, we are asking our Objective-C++ person, give me your name, and give me the length of your name, something like that. So here we are again. This is the Objective-C++ class. And you can see here, what happens is that we are asking our C++ object, you, give me your name, convert it to a C language string, because of course, you know, the common denominator between Objective-C and C++ is actually C rather than C++ itself. And then we are performing some sort of conversion of this string in order to create a string in the Objective-C world, you know, what it's called the NS string in this case. This is what we are returning. Right, so let me minimize this. Let's keep running. And now we are in the last portion of this execution. We are still in the same method, you know, formatting the message. We are now in the last portion. We are asking this Objective-C++ element, give me the length of your name. I guess that in this case I, oh. Sorry about this, you know, it's like, I have two screens here, but they are inverted, you know, so when I'm moving with the arrow, it's like I'm going the wrong way. All right, so we are here in the Objective-C++ method, which delegates in terms, you know, to the C++ method, give me the name of your length. If we go back to this is where our execution has stopped, you know, so we are again in the C++ camp. Likewise, we came from C++ objects, we can eventually invoke back Objective-C methods using the same methodology. So, any questions so far? I mean, this is all the magic, you know, this is the way you can get it. And seems like we have the problem solved in some way, you know? It's like, okay, so we are ready now, we are C++ developers, we are ready to start coding applications in iOS. It's one of the most used platforms in the post-PC world. The reality will show other aspects, you know, and I want to focus a little bit about that before. Let me just switch back to my presentation. So I want to tell how much, you know, post-PC applications are kind of different than PC applications. And there are a lot of needs that we will require C++ to deliver to us. First of all, post-PC applications are different in the sense that you won't find in tablets or smartphone applications the kind of, you know, like all-in-one things application that could do a lot of things, you know, like a suite of applications where you get everything. In general, what it happens with post-PC applications are they are simple applications that can do, you know, like two or three compelling things, but they do those things pretty well, you know? So there are certain ranges of applications that are emerging these days. One is called applications that feature natural user interfaces. So you can immediately think, okay, gestures, for instance, you know, gesture recognition, etc. That is now part of the past. A few weeks ago, Samsung has announced that the next version of the Galaxy S4, is going to have something called eye tracking that has been there for a while, you know, but now it's like they found a way to commoditize that and package and deliver that in a smartphone. So this is a true story that happens to me every morning, or at least the mornings I shave my beard. What it happens is that maybe I'm reading news in the phone, but I, you know, I have my hands wet, and maybe I have shaving cream, etc., and I don't want to damage the device, you know, or the phone, etc. What eye tracking can do, as I'm reaching the bottom of the page, eye tracking recognizes that, and they are shifting the text, so I don't even need to use my hands, you know, to scroll the text. Isn't that awesome? So they are taking these, you know, natural user interfaces to the next level. And of course, C++ is very compelling for that, you know, because you really need to act fast, you know, you really need to detect the movement and react as soon as possible. So it's always better, you know, than a managed language that is running in a virtual machine. However, we don't have access, at least in iOS, or it's not documented, to get access to sensors directly from C++. You need to bridge back to Objective-C, you know? So maybe the benefit you are getting in terms of running on the metal is in some way being eroded because you are crossing the bridge back and forth. Another example I have here is related to augmented reality. So this is, again, something that is maximizing the use of sensors in a device. For instance, we are getting the input signal from the camera, but we are enhancing the image we are exposing by maybe, you know, using location or other sensors, the GPS, etc., making some, let's say, certain queries about restaurants in the area, etc., and we are giving back an enhanced image, you know, that it's exposing more information. You may remember the movie Terminator in 1984, 1985. The guy has, you know, the guy was in some way predicting augmented reality, you know, it's like the guy could observe a scene and see certain messages, you know, like, you know, certain information about where where he was, and take certain decisions based on that, you know? So now we have Google Glass and this kind of devices making that a sort of reality. C++ is a very compelling technology. The problem we have in Cocoa, or Cocoa Touch, which is the framework that is being used in iOS, is that we don't have direct access, or at least it's not documented, how to get direct access to these portions of the platform that make applications very compelling in C++. We need to, you know, bridge back from Objective-C through Objective C++. So I took this directly from the website, the iOS developer website, and there is a phrase in particular that calls my attention. They are talking about Cocoa and the benefits of using Cocoa, etc., and they say that it was implemented for Objective-C developers, etc., and they said because Objective-C is a superset of C, it's easy to mix C and even C++ into your Cocoa Touch applications. As a C++ enthusiast, I react when I read this. I said, why an even C++? You use the word even when you want to emphasize something that was in some way unexpected. And I would have expected that including C++ would have been something normal, you know? Maybe you can say it was a random fact, maybe when they wrote the phrase. However, it was not the only case. Paul Turrett is a journalist and a technologist. He has a site, Windows Supersite, and he's a specialist on Windows. So he got, like a few years ago, some inside information about something by then known as Jupyter, the code name. You know, is what today we all know is the Windows runtime framework, you know, for Windows 8 and Windows Phone 8, etc. So he was talking about his findings regarding that, and he said, okay, you can now, you know, natively run certain applications, and these applications can be written in C Sharp, in Visual Basic, and even C++. So when we say even C++, you know, sounds like, okay, so you are back on the game, you know? And then when you really try to do this, you find in the case of iOS, for instance, well, you need to learn a little bit about Objective-C, you know, because you cannot grab, you know, those elements directly. So you say, okay, I mean, but the learning curve is going to be faster. For an Objective-C developer, he or she was already there. She doesn't need to learn, you know, C++ if they don't want to use it, you know. In our case, and in particular, I want to refer to this example, Microsoft finally delivered on promise, or more or less. They came out with a language that is called C++ CX. It's like an extension on C++. We need to learn prior to use it, and it's actually solving a Microsoft problem, not our problem. It's because the WinRT framework is based on COM, and in order to deal with COM in a way that is affordable, you know, timely, etc., okay, we need to use an extended syntax. It's okay, and it runs, and it's native. Thank you. But it's not C++. I mean, you go to the website, and they say, this is the JavaScript version, this is the C# version, this is the C++ version. That is not C++. I mean, I challenge Microsoft. I will get that source code. I will try to compile that with JCC and see how many errors I get, you know? If they say that this is C++, I say, I'm not talking about linker errors. I'm talking compile errors. The syntax is not straight C++. Syntax. So, because everybody's saying an even C++, you know, like the unexpected visitor, and at the end of the day it ends up by not being really C++, I was to propose some errata, you know, for media journalists and people talking about even C++. So every time they are going to say an even C++, let's call it an even C++. You know, it's kind of similar, but it's different. It's uneven for a couple of reasons. First of all, for a segmentation reason. We get different approaches for C++ that are not in parity to what you can get with the platform native language. When I say native, I'm not talking about something that is running on the metal. You might be aware that in the post-PC era, media is referring to native languages to mean the language that is strategic for the platform. So the native language in iOS is Objective-C, which is not native. It's a dynamic language. It has a runtime, so it cannot be native, or at least it doesn't run on the metal. And in the case of Android, the native language is Java, which is definitively not native, you know? So we are now C++ in this case. So we are uneven in terms of the native approach taken by the platform, and the second reason we are uneven is because if we compare the approach taken for C++ developers across the different platforms, it's not the same. So we have the problem of fragmentation here. It's another problem. I mean, have you been delivering C++ applications for iOS? Yes. Okay, you might try to reuse your experience in Android, for instance. Well, it's not comparable because their approach is different, their libraries are different, etc. So this is something we need to discuss tonight. Don't want to answer this question right now, but one of the reasons we choose C++, and we typically say I choose C++ because of that, the most common one is because it runs on the metal. But the other one usually is because you can get C++ compilers everywhere. The language is portable. And I said, because of the segmentation and the fragmentation. If we are talking about an average application today, how much portable could be the C++ application in this case? I'm not trying to get the question answered right now. We will address this issue later. I want to focus a little bit back about the challenges that are posed by post-PC applications, And the reason I'm encouraged to do that is because I want to mean that C++ shouldn't put more obstacles, or you know, the C++ approach shouldn't put more obstacles than the obstacles we already have when we want to engage with this industry. First of all, we have to address multiplicity, you know? So for instance, I'm going to show now how is the market share inside iOS about the different versions of the platform inside Android, and you will see that when you want to succeed with post-PC applications, you need to understand where most of the customers are today, what version they are today, and you need to come out with an application that runs on that version. You know, otherwise you are leaving certain people behind, and eventually your chances for revenue. Is understandable? You also have multiplicity of devices. You know, you have smartphones that have a small screen, maybe 4 inches at most. You know, you also have tablets, 10 inches, 7 inches, etc. And you want to come out with an application that nicely scales out or shrink down, you know, depending on the device. So you also need to take care about that. I know that some people could be encouraged to say, I'm just a developer, you know, I mean, maybe some graphical designer is going to take care of that. But in the post-PC world, the typical teams for post-PC applications are composed maybe, you know, by five people, you know, and you don't have like multiplicity of roles. One of the reasons is, don't even dream that post-PC applications are applications that you can sell, let's say, for $120 or even $40, you know, they are usually $1, $4, or maybe free, you know, so you won't have, at least these days, you won't have a lot of people willing to work for so much, you know, so low chances of revenue. We will keep talking a little bit about that later. There are also other challenges, because this is not the PC world. In the PC world, you could test your application in the same architecture you were coding. In this case, you have emulators, but before going live, you really need to test the application in different devices you are expecting the application to run. So this is, again, another challenge you have. And in order to make the business viable, you need to have a mechanism for customers to discover that your application is there. Of course, application stores are helping us a lot, you know? I mean, you create your iOS application, and they have a store where people can find you by just searching. But because the app stores are growing more and more, your chances of being discovered could be lower, you know? Because in the small screen of a smartphone, maybe it could fit, let's say, 7 items, you know? I mean, 7 items by scrolling, and then you need to click a button to get another bulk of applications. So you could get lost, you know, in that multitude of applications that are out there. So you need to have, even as a developer, switch hats and have a marketing plan in order to get discovered. You also need to think about a monetization strategy. Okay, we are now talking about Google Play. Most of applications are free. Does it make sense that I say that my application is $1 you need to pay just to download? I mean, with so much competition, maybe they will find some similar application that is free, and I lost all attention, you know, by customers. So it's something to think about that. So, and of course, the last item is time to market. It's becoming more and more competitive. So the portability of C++ would be awesome, because you create the application once and then you can just compile and deploy to many platforms. If you need to come out with a version per platform, maybe your competitors are using PhoneGap or another technology that are coming faster. So again, it's another issue you need to deal with. So fortunately, in the case of iOS, the fact that iOS is that, you know, how can I say, that obscure object of desire makes that every time they come with a new version of the platform, most of their loyal customers go there, you know? So you can typically say, I will focus in the latest and greatest version. And I will not worry about, you know, the remaining, let's say, almost 20% in the case of the iPad, etc., you know? And it's all fine, you know, because I'm still being inside, you know, the majority of the audience. So we will see how this works in Android. It's not exactly like that, but there are some reflections to share with you about the App Store opportunity. So let's imagine a quadrant here. You know, you have applications in your same category. So in the x-axis, you know, if you approach to the zero, there are less applications, what increases your chances to be discovered. The more applications that fall in that category, your chances of being discovered lower. At the same time, you have the customer base. So once you are discovered, discovered, how many customers could eventually be converted into paid customers? If the customer base is small, maybe you don't have, you know, chances even if you are discovered. If the customer base grows, your chances are greater, you know? So there is some sort of comfort zone here when a platform emerges, like the case, for instance, of the Windows Store, which was open, you know, like less than a year ago. And it's still, we could say, it's still in the lower left quadrant, you know? It's still, it doesn't have a lot of applications, so your chances of being discovered are higher. At the same time, the customer base is not yet too high, so it's something that they are just, you know, mounting the curve. So you can say that after that, you know, as more and more applications are coming to the App Store you are trying to target, maybe the opportunity is being lower. You know, so I'm not saying you are going to earn less money, it depends on the application, but this is in average what you could expect. The good thing is that not all the App Stores are the same, you know? So there are some strange things that happen and they deserve some attention. In the case of iOS, the audience of the iOS devices are people who, in general, they could eventually pay. They are, you know, they are used to pay when they go to the App Store and they find applications there. Of course, if they find free alternatives, they may feel the temptation, but in general, when there are certain research is made about the profit that developers can do. And it's like Android was growing, but still, you know, iOS is, or the App Store is still the one that offers better chances for direct profit. So in the case of Google in particular, we must remember that Google is a search company who makes its bucks from advertising. So in the case of Google, what it happens is, first, they deliver the operating system for free at no charge. They don't make any dime for the operating system. They try to get the operating system delivered in budget devices. And you can imagine that later that audience is the same audience that if they find something for free, they will probably take it. If they see something for profit, chances are lower, you know? And this is what statistics are showing. So you can still make money with that. They have a technology called AdMob, and AdMob can segment advertisements, you know, based on the region, based on the language of the application, based on, you know, certain pivots. So you can get your applications using these technologies in order to drive maybe money through advertisement. So there is a third category that is known as freemium. So you let users or customers to download the application for free. Maybe you are offering ads, but there are certain features that if they want to get those features, once they are getting used to the application, they need to pay extra. So those are the ones that are called freemium. They are free, but have certain premium features. And in general, what it plays better in cases like Google Play, etc., is B and C combined. So any questions so far? Yes.
So far you talked about applications for consumer market. Do you have any comments for business applications?
Well, business applications, yes. Tonight I'm focusing more in the customer segment. Of course, when we are talking about C++, in this case, it's applicable for any kind of application. It's a general purpose language, you know? So you can still, you know, based on the demos I'm doing tonight, you can apply those technologies for business applications as well. Understanding business applications, applications that are running in the devices that are provided by an organization to their employees. Is that the case?
Yeah, but what about, for example, monetization? Is it also a couple bucks or more?
Can you repeat the question, please?
You're
Yes.
So what about arthritis for business applications?
Well, of course, I mean, these are not, you know, like not absolute rates. It depends, you know, on the application you're talking. I have seen applications being sold by $20, etc. You know, I don't believe that there is a metric that's saying if it's a business application, it's going to be sold, you know, by this amount. It depends on the application and the opportunity. Lloyd. Yes.
So you're always going to be playing that game. Smaller base, bigger dollars, back and forth.
Yes. So it's jumping randomly, you know, from one topic to another. I will now, you know, certain considerations. We are talking C++, but put in the context of the post-PC era. I will focus now a little bit on Android and how C++ plays in this platform. What I'm showing here is a screenshot of what they have in their developer center regarding C++. So I want to read some passages of this, because I was saying in the case of iOS, okay, you had C++, but not C++ if you wanted to access the true platform, you know, for augmented reality apps or for applications that are fostering natural user interfaces, etc. Let's pay attention how Android or Google talks about C++ in their platform. They said, before downloading the native development kit, you should understand that the NDK will not benefit most apps. As a developer, you need to balance its benefits against its drawbacks. Notably, in their opinion, using native code on Android generally does not result in a noticeable performance improvement, but it always increases your application complexity. Thank you for the publicity, you know, I mean, a lot of developers will want to come to this meeting next month, probably. In general, you should only use the NDK if it's essential to your application, and this is a shot to my heart, never because you simply prefer to program in C++. They shot me dead, you know, I mean, what can I do after they said so, you know? So it looks like Google or Android, apparently, are discouraging you to use C++. The reality, fortunately, is totally the other way around. Their support is one of the widest support to what we call native development and managed development in a mobile platform these days. It's just that they say, hey, it's there. Think twice before using it, but it's there, you know? It's not the case that you need to bridge, you know, to another technology, etc. So, this is some remarks I want to do. You can program entire applications without any single line of Dalvik Java in Android, in the Android platform. You have native APIs that, of course, they are not standard, they are just Android-based, but you can access all the sensors, the magnetometer, the gyroscope, you know, the accelerometer, etc. You can also keep the activity lifecycle in the Android jargon. An activity, we could say, is the screen of an application in some way. It has a lifecycle, you know, it could be paused, it could be resumed, etc., when some other application takes focus. Like iOS, and I haven't mentioned in the case of iOS, but you have, you know, OpenGL version 1.1, 2.0. Android, in particular, delivers C++ by default, but Clang is also bundled and you can eventually use it. By default, you cannot use the standard template library, but it's there and you can activate it, you know, I mean, if you try to create a project on C++, where it comes out of box, it doesn't have the standard template library linked. You can do it that manually, and you cannot also throw exceptions, which I would say that it's maybe something to just leave as is. You can eventually activate exceptions. I mean, you can do full C++ in the Android platform if you want. It's just something that out of box, they are in some way disabling. In the case of iOS, I forgot to mention, but Xcode, which is the IDE I was showing before in the demo, comes with Clang. Clang is the C++ compiler that these days is getting most of the momentum. You know, it's the one that has most implemented the C++ 11 standard, and they are now jumping to C++ 14, the early draft that are out there. So I used the analogy of Janus, you know, with two faces in the case of Objective-C. In the case of JNI, the technology that Android is leveraging, we could see this maybe like crossing a bridge, back and forth. So we have on the left, you know, like a Java component that needs to do something that is maybe too much for Java, a managed language, to be performed. So the developers take the decision, let's do this in, you know, in a technology that is running directly on the metal. So Java, the original Java, came with this technology. It's called Java Native Interface. It's not necessarily C++. It's actually, you know, a technology that it's mostly based on C language, and because of that, you can, in coding Mac OS applications, you can use JNI in order to leverage Objective-C in the Mac platform. So you will discover that you cannot make a Java component to speak directly with a C++ component. In this case, the man in the middle is a C function that is exported, and we will see that now in a demo. So most of the samples that Android delivers aren't actually using C++, because they say native, and at all times when they say native, they are not talking about any language in particular. And by not talking any language in particular, you will find that in most of cases they were actually talking about C and not C++. But you can, of course, from C, you can use C++ and compile C++, etc. So let's go to this. Can you see this well? All right, so what I have here is, again, I will run this application directly. Yes, no, this is on purpose. I'm not making now the code bigger because I don't want you to read the code. I want you to listen what I'm saying at this time. But this is an application that is leveraging OpenGL. You all know that OpenGL is not a technology that is exclusive of C++ or C language. OpenGL is actually an open standard, and you can find OpenGL for a myriad of programming languages. In particular, in Android, you have OpenGL available for Dalvik Java, and in the case of iOS, you have OpenGL available for Objective-C. So this is the case of an application, and it's a scenario that could happen often, that if you need to apply OpenGL from the platform native language, I mean from Objective-C or Java, could be a little bit chatty, because you are at all times crossing the boundaries from a managed language to an unmanaged one. This is, you know, what I was trying to mean. So you need to do, let's put it between quotes, the marshalling and unmarshalling of parameters. You need to convert the information back and forth, and maybe that could be diluting the benefits of using a technology that is running or could leverage eventually the CPU, etc. So in this case, they decided, okay, let's start the application. This is a sample. This is one of the samples that comes with Android. This is nothing that I have created. The application used Java just to bootstrap the activity, but once there, it generates an OpenGL component that is running on native code, on C++ code. Let's call it properly, C++ code, and is using OpenGL directly. So I will not drill down too much on the code, because it's OpenGL code that doesn't matter much what it's doing. But what we have here, let me try to find here. Let me try to switch back to the activity. First, I will close this source code. Where I am. Okay. I have two screens, and believe me, this is driving me crazy because when I want to go, you know, to the left or to the right, it's actually the opposite of what I have to do here. All right. So this is the DNA in Android. This is Java activity, which is like the lowest portion of an application, and it has certain events you can override, you know, for some application events like every time your application is paused, etc. Something that I want to emphasize here is that as soon as the application is being created, it instantiates this component, which is again is a Java component still, you know, Java component, and this component is what in Android is called a view, which are a set of widgets, you know, like a text field is a view or a widget, a button is a widget, a drop down list is a widget, etc. So in this case, this kind of widget is a widget that is capable to expose an OpenGL surface. Let me jump to this code. So this guy here has certain initialization functions using still OpenGL from the Java side. It's just populating certain structures that are going to be used to initialize the component. However, at some point, we'll find it downward. Where I am. Need to minimize a little bit because. Okay, I have this element here, which is called the renderer class. This is like one of the OpenGL classes in the case of Android Java applications. So this class, in particular, is leveraging, you know. It's a class that is being called every time you need to draw a frame. So this is something that is systemic, it's part of the OpenGL interface for Android applications. But this class is delegating in this other class that appears here, and we will check next, that is a class that is bridging between Java and C++. There is another case here on surface changes, is every time, you know, the element, the OpenGL scene has changed its internal parameters, so needs to be redrawn again. So it's again invoking this CL2 CNI lib, and we will inspect that next. So if we go upward here, we can see, I'm not sure how much familiar you are with Java, but in Java, you can put these code segments inside what is called a static block. When you have that, is the first time the Java virtual machine is instantiating the component, is executing this the code that appears between the braces. So in this case, what it's doing is invoking a system component, I mean a Java virtual machine component, and it's loading a library, which is a native library in this case. This is a library that contains our C++ logic. And then it's also making clear that there are like a couple of native functions that are these two that appear here, you know, init and step. One receives two arguments, the other doesn't receive any. And these were the two functions that we have seen in that renderer component before. This is the component that was implementing some system interface, you know, some OpenGL interface. Any questions so far? Are we good? Are we okay? Keep going? Cool. So, let me minimize this again. I'm just trying to find a way, you know, to. Okay, I think that this time I got it nailed. So if we go here, we will see that in Android projects that use C++, there's usually a directory called CNI And in this directory, we can put all the native logic we want to implement. So this class here, glcode, is the one that implements, you know, our C++ portion. I think that it won't be a good idea that we start checking all the entire OpenGL code here. I guess that we all will fall asleep. In particular, I guess that I will probably do it. But I want to just scroll down to the bottom, to the part where we are exposing certain methods. And here there are some JNI conventions to follow. You remember that there was that component, that Java component JNI lib, that exposed those native methods, right? The one that we saw before. I can show it back if you like, but this is the source code, the source file that we just checked. So what we have in the Java camp, sorry, in the C++ camp is the counterpart of that. We have something whose name should be exclusively Java with capital J underscore, then it comes the name of the Java package where that component belongs to, then is the name of the Java class, and then it's the name of the method that we had there, you know? So this is the way we are gluing both components at both camps. And you will notice something else. One of the methods received 4 arguments, being the last 2 width and height, you know, like the component we just saw, but in that case were just 2 components, and those 2 components were the last 2 components we have in the C++ case. And the other method just received 2 components and nothing else. What we have seen recently was one of the methods in the Java camp has width and height, and the other wasn't receiving anything. The fact is that when you are using JNI, what it happens is that there are 2 objects that are being sent by default. The first one, it's an object of the class, it's a pointer to an object of the class CNIEMB, and we can consider this a proxy to the Java virtual machine. So this is an object we can use in order to, for instance, to throw an exception to the Java code, you know, or to convert elements from one system to the other, or perform certain activities from the native world in the hosting Java virtual machine. The second object, this J object, OBJ, it should be actually the object who called us. So it's like sending this as an argument. It's implicit. We don't need to send it. So this is the way this works. So we can run this application. Let me just try to minimize this. So I have just instantiated an emulator. One of the great things about Android, or Google in particular, is that they deliver an Eclipse that is flavored for Android development. So it comes out of box with certain project types that are Android project, JUnit Android project, etc. And it also comes with a series of emulators. So one of the criticisms about the Android platform is that you have too much fragmentation across vendors. You can, in the Java camp, you can lay out your screens and you can see in parallel how that screen will look like in different devices, you know, at different resolutions, different inches, etc. So in this case, I have triggered an emulator running, you know, the application in question. It's just an OpenGL application. Not much to be done, but so we can eventually, another day, we can just take a look about the logic of the application, but this application is OpenGL directly in the native camp. So, questions so far? It's okay, it's understandable, too basic, or maybe my accent just make everything impossible to follow. All right. So this is something that I really admire about Google. They are publishing this dashboard every other week. So this is the distribution of their customer base, in particular those that visit the Google Play Store. So they, in certain way, they are tracking the different operating system versions they are using in the Google Play Store, because this is where your applications could be sold. And they tell you, you know, well, actually 38%, the majority of the population, it's still in the version that we could consider the Windows XP in the Android platform. It's old, it's probably not the ultimate or the penultimate, it's actually one in the middle, but many customers feel very comfortable and they stay there. It's actually not that these customers are reluctant to migrate to a newer version. It's just that the devices they are using aren't capable to get, you know, maybe a more modern version like Ice Cream Sandwich and Jelly Bean, etc. And because this is the budget platform, you know, the less costly platform, what it happens is that usually they grab an audience that who could change the phone maybe every 3-4 years, you know, or whatever it lasts, you know. So this is one of the reasons this is they don't have the lack iOS is getting with most of their customers in the latest version, as we have seen. So this is a different approach than the approach Apple has taken. In this case, you don't need to have, you know, Objective-C++. You use this bridge called JNI. This is different than the approach Microsoft is taking with their C++, CX, or their component extensions for the Windows runtime, etc. One of the questions we may ask, reflecting about C++ itself, is why is so easy for platform vendors to fork the original, you know, the original draft of the programming language and try to come out with a solution of theirs? And one of the things that I realized is that the standard C++, you know, the standard template libraries, etc., are covering actually too little of what an average application today could need. Let me do a little bit of history. Let me go to the times where C++ was invented. The world was different than today, and in particular, I mean, it was different in many, you know, in many perspectives. In particular, in the IT perspective, mainstream applications by them were not graphic applications. You know, in the 80s, most of applications were text-based. So if you offered as only, you know, unique user interface, console in, console out, was just about fine because you were in parity with the rest of the industry, you know? So by then, relational database management system already existed. But again, they were not mainstream. Most of organizations were using indexed files, like the VSAM files, you know, in the mainframe environment, or RMS, etc. SQL was something that was well known by then, but nothing that was widely used. Then times started changing, you know. So in the 90s, we started getting other industry forces, like, for instance, you know, it like databases became, you know, ubiquitous. I mean, they were everywhere. The internet erupted, so networking became more relevant than ever. So we needed actually components to be able to speak HTTP or FTP. We were able to send messages in XML. We were able, as I was saying, you know, to do to perform SQL commands, maybe transactionals, etc. And the industry responded with two platforms since the mid 90 decade, you know, it's like Java in one camp and .NET in the other, you know. So they were the two major contenders. So the question I have to ask, reflecting out C++, is what has happened with C++? I mean, the standard in particular never offered anything for graphic user interfaces, never offered anything, you know, as a standard way to access databases, transactional databases. I remember that article. My friend here was writing about threads, you know, in C++. And I don't remember exactly the title of the article, but you were saying something like not quite there, you know, because the support for multi-threading in C++ was a step in the right direction, but still, you know, too little, too late for what the applications need today. In particular, if we start comparing to other platforms. So what happens in general is that when we try to apply C++ for an average application today, we cannot keep everything under the C++ boundaries. We always need to loop to another technology. Like I was showing before, you know, Objective-C or Java, or maybe, you know, this COM-based library that Microsoft is offering. So I said something before. We need to be able to answer today the question, are C++ applications portable? C++ is a portable language for a basic reason, intrinsic reason. There are C++ compilers at every platform, you know? However, the fact that the C++ compiler is present at all platforms doesn't mean that when you decide to write an application, you can solve everything with what that compiler is offering out of box. So I try my approach to measure the portability of a C++ application. And the, you know, the portability will be based on the percentage of line of code that are written in ISO C++ contrasted with the percentage of application that you are using either, you know, a non-standard C++ library, so it's still C++ but not standard C++, like the case of Android, and also the lines of code that you will spend writing that bridging technology, you know, like Objective-C in one case or JNI, because you can come up with some sad conclusions as it happened to me. I was coding a game for the Android platform, and this game was using a very intensive usage of natural user interfaces, because I have to take care about, let's say, you know, gestures that were happening in the UI, etc. And C++ had nothing to do in that case. I could still say, okay, I will keep, you know, the domain application logic inside C++, and I will access that using JNI or any other technology. But in practice, what was happening is that the most important activity of my application was happening at the lower level of this cocktail, you know? So I could finally cross the JNI bridge to go to the C++ camp just to find, you know, if the coordinates of two elements were too close to say, hey, you know, you have hit the, you know, the goal, etc. Maybe too little. I mean, if just for doing that, I can do that, you know, in Dalvik Java, etc. And I don't need C++, you know. So the fact that the standard library of C++ covers so little increases the chances that increases your chances to have to look back in another technology or programming language for an application with the needs of nowadays applications. Is that clear? It's okay? Are we good? So, as a sad conclusion I have tonight is that C++ has lost the battle in the enterprise camp in the last decade, right? I mean, the decision was between J2E or Java Enterprise Edition and .NET. And C++ could eventually miss the chance in the post-PC arena, even being very suitable for this territory, because post-PC applications are running in an architecture like ARM, which is more limited than the Intel architecture. So C++ is more suitable. Also, these kind of applications are making intensive usage of, as I said, natural user interfaces, augmented reality, and other things that need to happen very fast, you know, maximizing the usage of sensors, etc. This kind of issues I'm mentioning, like the lack of coverage from the standpoint of the standard C++ for this kind of needs, could make C++ to miss the opportunity again. So let's go to the last segment of my presentations. There are still chances for C++ to catch this train, you know, and stay on the game. I remember an anecdote that happened with the Java platform like 10 years ago. 10 years ago, Java Enterprise Edition was becoming so much complicated, that there were certain analysts saying Java is on its way to become the next COBOL. I mean, organizations will keep it because the investment made on Java was so huge that nobody will drop the ball, you know, so easily. However, it's something that is not that compelling anymore. Java was becoming complicated because they were trying to cover most of the needs of an enterprise application, like transactional unity, you know, database access, web pages. There was a technology in particular that annoyed a lot of developers. That was called Enterprise Java Beans. It was way too complicated, you know? It was like their answer to COM or DCOM or COM Plus, if you like, you know? Distributed components that you could keep the life cycle remotely, etc., and ask things remotely. Was so much complicated that most of developers gave their back, you know, and nobody, or almost nobody used it. Those who did it regretted having done, you know, so the community saved Java, finally. There was a framework, it exists today and it's pretty famous, it's called Spring Framework, and Spring Framework tried to put some coherence and consistency in what was, by then, you know, the complications of the Java platform. So, Spring Framework was a community effort. It emerged from the community and for the community and immediately got widely used, etc. And we could say that saved the Java platform from becoming the next COBOL. You know, it's like most of organizations said, okay, we are not going to do the path of the official Java Enterprise Edition, but we will try to have a Java Enterprise Edition server, but we will use Spring Framework and leverage, you know, things like dependency injection, plain objects, you know, Java beans, etc. So I will show how the story could be repeated in the post-PC camp with C++. I'm not promising anything. I'm just saying, you know, there are ways using here like a sort of typo, you know, fulfilling the C++ promise. What promise? What promise? I have discussions with my colleagues today when we talk about C++, and I lament the fact that C++ today is not so much present. And they say, well, you are understanding wrong this movie. C++ is not actually a general purpose language. C++ is for high intensive computing. Shut up! Who are you to say something like that? C++ was created as a general purpose language. I mean, it was created in the 80s, you know? Of course, it lacks a lot of libraries that should have today, but this is because it just have lost the train somewhere in the 80s, you know? But it's a general purpose language. I mean, I challenge anybody to find the C++ programming language book and find any sentence, any paragraph that Bjarne is saying, this is not a general purpose language, this is just for high intensive computing. Was not the idea, was for everything. Was bringing the level of abstraction that the Jourdan methodology needed in terms of the structure, analysis, and design, right? So, the framework we are going to review, in particular, the first one is the one that I'm going to put most of the emphasis, are frameworks that could make our lives easier when we try to make common C++ that later targets different platforms. I will show some demos tonight and I will finish with that. The first framework I'm going to discuss is called Cocos2D-X. It's a port of some framework called Cocos. I believe that was originally created for the iOS platform. I'm not much sure, I should review Wikipedia in order to make sure, but this port in particular is the port devoted to us, you know, I mean, it's a port for the C++ developers. So you can notice that the framework is mostly for casual games. You know, casual games are games whose instructions aren't too much complicated, are games that a guy like I, for instance, could play, you know, when I'm in the waiting room of my dentist or something like that, you know. This is not the kind of games you can get in an Xbox or Nintendo Wii, etc. So, you have certain libraries here for graphics, for audio, for, you know, like certain physics and sensors. Sensors like the accelerometer. You don't get here something like, okay, an API for location or things like that. So when we were talking about natural user interfaces, you can get some here, you know, using the accelerometer. If you were talking more about, let's say, augmented reality using location, etc., you will need something else because this assist doesn't suffice. But it's a very good approach, you know? And you can see in the bottom line all the platforms that are already being covered by this framework, you know? So it's maybe the kind of call we were expecting from the beyond. So the demo I'm going to show now is a demo that shares a common C++ base and the bulk of the application is written in this common C++ base, but the application is being bootstrapped both by iOS and by Android. This is not a demo I made, this is a demo I found in the internet, and is compelling enough, you know, to be shown tonight. So I think I can get rid of this guy now. Let me put back its code. Let me do my stuff here. I will later maximize this screen, but I guess that there is. All right, here we go. So I will just close this one. And move this one here. All right. So this is like the space game, or the beginning of a space game. You can find this demo on the internet and can play a little bit, you know, on your own with it. It has certain components that, as I was saying before, they are bootstrapping, you know, the main component of the application, that is a C++ component that makes everything out the game, you know, the UI portion, the behavioral portion, etc. So you will find here, you know, something that I have. This is Xcode, you know, this is the development environment for iOS. I have here importing as a library the framework itself. So these are lines of code that are coming to us for free. We don't need to do anything, and that architecture diagram I showed in the previous slide are making seamless the differences, you know, between platforms, so we can just leverage these common components and put our application on top of that. So my application itself, it's just containing this folder, classes. There is like an anchor element, that is this element called appDelegate. Looks like every time you want to use this component, either in iOS or Java, or on Android or any other platform, you need to provide this application delegate, because it's the class that the bootstrapping component will try to give control once the application is running. So then most of the application happens at the level of this class. I just call it Hello World Scene, because I was making this example based on what I found in the internet, and I was already, you know, running this version of the application. So you can see here, you know, this is like regular C++. Of course, this is not necessarily standard C++. I'm using a lot of classes like CC Scene here, or CC Sprite Batch Node, etc. These are not standard C++ component, but the good thing is that this framework I'm using keeps these elements in synchronism, you know, across different platforms. So we can leverage all them together. I will just run this application to see how it looks like. Let's see. Sorry about that. I guess that, okay. So this is basically, you know, the emulator. It's using OpenCL internally. It's running, you know, like, it's leveraging certain components, like, for instance, sprites, OpenCL graphics, etc., using the GPU in the case of the true device, not in the case of the emulator. And I will switch easily to the Android version of the game, and you will see that it's basically the same code base. There we go. Okay, so let me close this activity, close this project, and focus on this one here. So again, this is like a similar structure, right? I have in this folder the framework itself in C++. This is the version that runs on Android. I don't even need to worry about the content of these classes. I get them for granted. My code, again, as I shown in the Xcode case, is in this folder, classes. And these are, you know, like the same. This is actually the same code base. So you have here the opportunity of making the change once and then rebuild using both tool chains, and get the application updated in both platforms at once. Isn't that fantastic? And isn't that originally what C++ was meant for? So again, maybe a difference you will notice here is that in this Android-based IDE, which is based in Eclipse, you don't have the kind of syntax coloring you get in Xcode. This could be fixed because there are certain plugins that make that possible. It's just that you will notice that, in general, working with Eclipse for C++ development, you need to do more setup manually. You know, so this is what it happens. Other than that, this is the same environment. So I will run this application now. Let's see, space game. So this should trigger again. By the way, I haven't shown this, but Android has, you know, as I was saying before, the possibility to emulate different devices from different brands, different versions of the operating system, different resolutions, etc. Great. I got it, but it's starting up in this screen. Let's bring it to this screen. Let me just shift it. Okay, it's booting at this time. Let's put together both. It's definitely a full emulation, you know, so I need to wait for the setup to happen, unlock the screen, etc. So let's switch back to the presentation and, oh, well, it's already here. So if I move, it says here, waiting for home to be launched. If not, I will try to launch this directly. I don't believe it's here. There we go. So it has a different screen size, you know, but so of course, this depends more on the application. It depends how the application scale out, or, you know, or sync down, you know, depending different applications. But promised, this is exactly the same code base. So let me close this. Let's go back to our presentation. There is another framework. This is a framework, it's for profit. I mean, you need to pay in order to use it. There's nothing like a community edition that you can use it for free for non-profit projects, etc. You can try the framework for 30 days, then you need to pay a license. It's probably the most robust framework you can get, you know, for C++ development in the post-PC camp. You can get here access to anything, you know, I mean, you get C++ APIs, 4D accelerometer, gyroscope, you know, magnetometer, location, etc. And everything standard, everything portable. They claim in their web page that they are the only way to leverage OpenCL in the Windows family, because OpenCL is supported in the Windows operating system in the desktop version, but my understanding, as far as I know, is you cannot use OpenCL, for instance, in the new Metro interface or in Windows Phone 8, etc. You know, so the company Marmalade, they said that you can use it, you know, in the case of the Windows platform. Probably worth take a look to this framework if you really want to develop commercial applications using C++. Qt, what's going on with Qt? This is where it happens. Ironically, Qt was invented by Nokia, and today Nokia is probably not leveraging this platform anymore, you know, since they have that deal with Windows Phone. But Nokia has given the rights of this platform to a company called Digia. There was some sort of impasse, like last year or so, and now Digia is, you know, showing the roadmap about this platform. They had hosted like a couple of conferences recently, one in San Francisco, I believe that the other was in Berlin. So in some way they are showing that Qt is alive. You want to say?
Cool. For people who are interested in Qt, there are scheduled speakers.
Cool. So I was checking this platform this last month. Most of the progress they are doing is today in the PC era, you know, I mean, and I say PC including Macs, you know, and Linux. They have announced support for iOS and Android, but it's not yet ready. Some good news we can see about this is that the BlackBerry 10 application framework is entirely based on Qt. So you can do full C++ development in the BlackBerry 10 platform using C++ and the Qt framework you are used to, you know? So, and you have full access to the sensors there. So it's just a matter of time, I guess, I suspect they will port what they have already done for BlackBerry to the other platforms. The last one I wanna discuss tonight, it's something called MozSync. I'm not sure if you guys are familiar with this framework. So this is the way MozSync works. It's like, in some way, our vindication. This is particular for, in particular for HTML5 developers and C++ developers like us. So you can code your applications. They provide a series of APIs you can leverage. You can code your application in an abstract manner. And what they do, once you are done, they compile your application, but instead of producing native code that runs on the metal, it's kind of like LLVM, you know? The compiler is a sort of front-end, so it takes everything to some sort of intermediate code in these packages, and later, based on the platform you want to target, they translate that code back to what is called the native programming language of the platform. What I mean is, in the case of iOS, they are translating the code back to Xcode, to Objective-C. In the case of Windows Phone, for instance, they translate that to C#, you know, using the .NET framework for phone. The only case they keep the native code alive and kicking is in the case of the Android platform, you know? So it's another way to see a problem. The good thing is that you can still code on C++, but don't believe later that your code will run directly on the metal. I mean, based on what I'm saying now, you know, it's like it's going to be later translated back to the platform. But the good news about that is that it can leverage everything that the platform is offering. So I have just, you know, like a backup slide talking a little bit about OpenCL. Just for those of you who are not familiar, certain people says very likely, I can do entire applications in C++ in the post-PC world because I can, you know, even for the UI, I can use OpenCL. In practice, what is happening is that OpenCL is a technology for 3D applications, you know, so it could be a little bit too much if you want to code a simpler application that doesn't need to leverage OpenGL. As I was saying before, it's not exclusively C++. Something else to consider is that OpenGL for embedded systems, or OpenGL ES, is actually like a decimated version of the OpenGL we might know from the PC camp, you know. Something else is that the second version about OpenGL first is not backward compatible with OpenGL 1.0, and second, based on evidence, seems to be more complex than the other one, you know. So the good news is that it's being supported not just in Android and iOS, it's also supported in BlackBerry and many other platforms. So I think I'm done. I'm just past 2 minutes here. The conclusion here is, yes, of course, you can use C++ in post-PC applications. The developer story, if it is already complex in the PC camp, I dare to say that it's a little bit more complex, you know, in this new scenario of post-PC applications. First of all, because the integration with the platform is not uniform, you know, across different technologies like iOS or Android. And second, because it's more difficult here than in the PC camp to get an entire application end-to-end out of box. Something else I have discussed tonight is that it's just a reflection that we might notice that ISO C++ is not covering today all the needs that mainstream application can require. You know, we don't have XML today, we don't have RESTful protocols, Web 2.0, you know, HTTP, and a myriad of things that are obliging us to look back in another technology, increasing the complexity of our solution. And at the end of this session, I have shown in particular Cocos 2D, you know, a framework for casual games that could make the barriers a little bit lower, you know, for C++ applications. So with that said, I really thank you for your patience, and I'm open for your questions or comments or debate or whatever.